I don't think America stunted his style, and although he might have been taking coals to Newcastle, I think he showed them a few tricks.
Don's abrasive style proved as effective in California as it had in London. He was determined to carry through his grand ambitions, and record company incompetence enraged him. He knew he could do a better job himself.
One time we were at United Artists down here on Sunset, and he had ELO there, and something had upset him that the record company wasn't doing right, and he didn't go through the secretary, and he walked straight into the guy's office, and it was, the door was flung open, and he was pounding on the desk.
The person that was supposed to be promoting our record and wasn't, he just picked this desk up and just, well, the guy was sitting behind me, picked it up and pushed it over him, so the guy was like sitting under the desk, you know. Now do something with that record.
I think a lot of the lower echelon were scared because they'd heard that I was a bit of a slave driver, because the artists in turn would question me. They wanted to know if the record companies, if the management were doing everything possible to make their records a huge success. You can't pussyfoot around, you can't be soft. I had reached a stage in my career as a manager and promoter that I didn't want to do the work of a record company that was making millions out of my artists.
Arden knew it was time to establish his own record label, Jet. His artists were already contracted to a major record company. But this wasn't going to stop Don from getting his own way.
I walked in and I told them, this is goodbye. And they kind of smiled nervously and said, but Don, you're with us for another 5 years. In fact, there's one artist that's with us for 6 years. So I said, but that 6 years is over. And I stood up and went, bye. No man has ever done that. No man has ever done it or tried it. Nobody.
Fantastic ambition. I mean, he's probably too much ambition for his own good. I mean, he's not, he just doesn't want to make a band successful or make a band or a singer just get them a hit record. He wants them to be number one, you know, he wants them to fill football stadiums. He wants everything to be really huge.
Arden devised spectacular lighting and technical effects for ELO's live shows. These ensured that the band made headlines, even if the individual musicians weren't very distinctive. ELO set the pace for the new era of high-tech stadium rock.
Got to be part of Don Arden's imagination that brought it to the stage and made it an event just when people would have been writing him off and going, well, you know, he belongs in Gene Vincent's other leg. Like, but no, he looked, he understood, because it doesn't matter. You know, if you're trained in show business and you understand it and you have an inherent love and respect of the process, the wattage may change, the voltage may change, but the rules are the same, you know. Entertain, punters, no shortchanging.
I made sure that they went out with one of the great shows of that era.
ELO weren't the event. Like Don, Jet was the event.
You know, it was a dream come true when he had Jet Records. You know, the offices in London, the offices in Los Angeles.
In 1977 alone, ELO grossed over $10 million. Their earnings brought Arden the lifestyle he had always dreamed of, he bought Howard Hughes' house in Beverly Hills.
It was almost like Mission Impossible. The, you know, the car or the tape or the journey will self-destruct. You'd be met at a certain fork in the road by another car, and you would follow that car to the house. And the reasons were left unsaid as to why that was. You know, it could be that you might get lost, and it could be that Don didn't want you to know exactly where he lived. He would enjoy his home with you, but the routing was his business.
When I went to visit him in this wonderful home in Hollywood, it was amazing. It was something out of a Clint Eastwood movie. I was frisked. My family were frisked. It was like unbelievable. Like, who is this? It's like a Jewish Saddam Hussein up there. Who is this man on the top of the hill? You know. When I finally got to him, he kind of loved it. He loved this image of being the godfather. Because when I saw him, he would just say, hello, Bubbler, how are you? You know, it was just a lovely hello.
Here is the, we're going in, there's the guardhouse. Can you see the guardhouse? Can you see? That's the courtyard through there. When I was a boy, we didn't have a bathroom. We had to queue up every morning to get the one tap that had running cold water. If we wanted to wash with hot water, we had to put water in a kettle and heat the kettle up.
Sunrise, sunset, sunrise, sunset, swiftly flow the days.
Arden was at the pinnacle of his power and notoriety. He had brought his son and daughter into the company with the aim of founding an Arden family dynasty. The Al Capone of Pop was becoming the godfather.
I've sat with him next door to where, you know, he was doing his number two on the bathroom. Because, look at me now, Hollywood. I mean, it's like, you know, Jimmy Cagney and Grapefruit. Isn't this wonderful? I'm sitting here on the crapper, looking out over the whole of Beverly Hills, and Beverly Hills, if he wants to, can look at me.
Whether it was stadium pomp or punk rock, it was all old-fashioned showbiz to Don Arden. Even the supreme rock and roll swindler, Malcolm McLaren, was flabbergasted by the way Don tried to sign the Sex Pistols.
Well, I met him and he sat on a small stool in the middle of this vast ocean of a kitchen in Bel Air, a mansion that he'd obviously bought with his fame and riches, and he talked about how he could sign the Sex Pistols and there would be no problem because he knew senators and they could all be paid off and it's not a problem. The only thing is you cannot look at my books. And I guess it was a sort of manner and a way of working, and I'll come round tomorrow with a suitcase full of cash. And I think at the time, although I thought it was a wonderful tale and story, I personally, at that time, didn't think I could operate like that. It was strange, to say the least.
Not even the hard-boiled Don was immune to the heady effects of success. Uncharacteristically, he allowed his grip to slacken.
I thought that I would continue to rise just because it was me and just because I was successful. And I didn't realize that at that stage of my career and that stage of my life that if you wanted to stay at the top, you still had to work just as hard to stay at the top as you did getting there.
Clashes with the media were part of Don's regular routine. In 1979, reporter Roger Cook used Arden's dispute with singer Lindsay DePaul as an opportunity to challenge him, although only over the telephone.
Roger Cook, you go f*** yourself. You're already guilty of slander, and you will be served with a writ very shortly.
That's very kind of you. Perhaps you'd like to answer some of the complaints about you that go back a very, very long way.
Mr. Cook, you want to fight me? then you fight me. But remember one thing, when you fight the champion, you go 15 rounds. You've got to be prepared to go the whole way.
Quite happy to do that.
If you think that it's the end of it after you've done your program, you're mistaken. Now, you say what you like, right? I don't have to answer to you or anybody. You've been warned. I'll take you with one hand strapped up my ass. You're not a man, you're a creep.
Roger Cook's accusations came to nothing, and Arden emerged unscathed from his colourful encounter. There would be far graver consequences from an incident in the mid-1980s, when Don's rough-and-tumble style finally caught up with him. He believed an accountant at Jet's Los Angeles office had embezzled money. The man denied it. Don saw red.
What happened in my office was I actually finished up chasing him out because he wasn't going to stand there and fight with me. And I took a poke at him. He pulled himself together and ran. Well, I chinned him, that's all. That's all that happened. I chinned him. I would have liked to have done a lot more, but he ran.
Don pursued the accountant back to Britain, where a further confrontation took place. This time, Arden's quarry called the police. Don was charged and brought to trial at the Old Bailey.
I was told that the least I would do was 7 years.
Don was found not guilty. His son David, tried separately for a subordinate role in the affair, was jailed for several months. After the trial, Don vented his anger on the police officer in charge of the case.
And when I got up to him, he made an excuse of trying to be nice, and he said, "Oh, your passport's waiting for you, Mr. Arden." And I said, "Don't talk to me about my passport. Talk to me about my family, and talk to me about what you did to my son." I said, "I'm leaving for the States next week." I said, "And if you continue to harass my family or any member of my family, I said, I'll deal with you personally."
Don was finally free to return to America, but the damage was done. Daunting legal bills put an impossible strain on Jet Records. He had fallen out bitterly with his daughter several years earlier, and his ambitions for a family dynasty lay shattered.
When you go for the best lawyers, they want the highest money. So it was rather... It was rather hurtful, yes.
Once, Don had looked down on the record business from on high as he built his Arden empire. Seeing his plans in ruins, a less determined man would have settled for a quiet retirement. But Arden's energy remains undiminished, and as he plans another comeback, his passion for show business is as intense as ever.
He's a fighter. I mean, he's not going to sit down and go, "Why me?" or "Now I'm ruined, now what do I do?" He goes, "Fine, I've got to think of something else now. This is what I've done all my life. You know, there's another deal out there to be made."
You can't ever write off Don Arden as a person of today, because you don't know. You could, but you don't. But he is the type of person that tomorrow could walk around the corner, run into something, and go, "I can see that." He was the man that he was, and that's it, basically. You know, what you see is what you get forever.
Next Sunday's Mr. Rock and Roll is Peter Grant at the same time, 9 o'clock.
For more details on the managers featured in this series, plus information about key figures and how to survive the music industry, check out the Mr. Rock and Roll website at www.channel4.com.